محمد وآل محمد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على المبعوث رحمة من العالمين، سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا، أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على
محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الأخيار المنتجبين. In the name of Allah, the beneficent, the merciful, the gracious, the almighty, all praises be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of mankind, master of the day of judgment. My respected brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would like to begin by offering my condolences to the Imam of our time, Imam al-Mahdi hajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif, on the martyrdom of our third Imam, his grandfather, Imam Hussain ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the companions and the soldiers of our Imam, so we can take revenge for him, inshaAllah. And second of all, I would like to thank the brothers and sisters for their attendance and for giving me this opportunity to be with you guys throughout these upcoming nights of Muharram. My name is Jafar Hammoud. I grew up in Toronto. Raised in Toronto, I went to school there. And after I finished high school, I decided to go to the Hausa. And my choice was to go to the Hausa in Lebanon, in Beirut. And alhamdulillah, I've been 5 years there, and it's the best choice I've done in my life. And inshallah, I can, you know, give what I have. And inshallah, I can benefit from you guys as well. Inshallah, we can benefit through the lectures and through the majalis of Abi Abdullah and Hussain in these holy nights, and keep the issue of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam alive. Imam Sadiq salamullah alayhi says, "Ihyu amrana rahimallah man ahya amrana." Remember our cause and keep it alive. God may have mercy. May God have mercy on those who do. So let us begin with the salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله وعلى آلك المظلومين. صلى الله عليك يا مولاي وابن مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا غريب يا مظلوم كربلاء يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا ليتنا كنا معكم سيدي فنفوز والله فوزا عظيما. إمام المهدي عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف says in his famous زيارة زيارة الناحية, in which he graphically describes the events of Ashura and the agony that Imam Hussain salamullahi alayhi and his family went through, in which he says, As-salamu ala shayb al-khadir, peace be upon the gray hair that was dyed with blood. As-salamu ala الخد التريب, peace be upon the cheek that struck the dust. السلام على البدن السليم, peace be upon the butchered body. السلام على المقروع بالقضيب. me upon the teeth that were beaten by a rod. As-salamu ala ar-ra'is al-marfu'. Peace be upon that that was raised upon a lance. As-salamu alayka ya mawlaya ya aba abdillah. Wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل
محمد. الله سبحانه وتعالى says in the Holy Quran in Surah Al-A'raf, ayah number 35. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا بني آدم إما يأتينكم رسل منكم يقصون عليكم آياتي فمن اتقى وأصلح فلا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. O children of Adam, if a messenger comes to you relating to you my verses, then whoever fears Allah and reforms, then no fear is on them and nor will they grieve. Tonight's lecture, inshallah, will consist of a few points. First, in which it was pivotal for Imam Hussain salamullahi alayhi to head to Karbala. Second, why did Ashura specifically occur at the time of Imam Hussain? Why was he the chosen one to lead this revolution? Third, why didn't occur at the time of Amir al-Mu'mineen or Imam Hassan alayhi salam? And last but not least, what should we learn from Ashura? Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Imam Hussain alayhi salam, before he leaves Medina and heads to Karbala, he says in his famous hadith, which of course most of you know, all of you know inshaAllah, if a messenger, I did not revolt for the cause of evil tyranny or corruption, but to reform my grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's nation, I want to enjoin good and denounce the evil, and take the course of my father and grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi.
Allah.
So what is Imam Hussain salamullah alayhi telling us in this narration before heading to Karbala? What is Imam Hussain alayhi salam telling us about a city he loved, a city he was grew in, a city he was raised in with his father and his grandfather Rasulullah, a city in where his father raised him, his grandfather helped him out, his grandfather is buried there. What compelled our Imam Salamullahi Alayhi to head to Karbala? These are questions we have to ask ourselves to understand the magnitude of Karbala. We can look at this narration by Imam Hussain when he says, إِنِّي لَمْ أَخْرَجُ أَشِرًا وَلَا بَطِرًا وَلَا مُفْسِدًا وَلَا ظَالِمًا إِنَّمَا خَرَجْتُ لِطَلَبِ الْإِصْلَاحِ فِي أُمَّةِ جَدِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ. اللهم صل على محمد وآل
محمد.
So what do these words really symbolize? Imam Hussain salamullahi alayhi is giving us the title of his revolution, the title and reason of his departure. I left to reform the nation of my grandfather. This nation, of course, that was without any doubt after the death of the Prophet, in complete trouble, as the Ummah split into two, as you guys know. After the death of the Prophet, a side accepted Amir al-Mu'mineen as the Khalifa, and a side rejected Amir al-Mu'mineen, and that was the majority. So they betrayed the Prophet, peace be upon him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly says this in the Quran, that they will betray the Prophet in Surah Al-Umran, ayah number 144. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Afa in mata aw qutila inqalabtum ala aqabikum. If he were to die or get killed, you will turn your backs on him. So these problems occurred because there was no true leader. Imagine the perfect leader, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, replaced by force, despite the Prophet, peace be upon him, appointing him as the successor. On the day of Ghadir, as you guys know, the Prophet, peace be upon him, when the Hajjaj were coming from the pilgrimage, he stopped the pilgrimage to shed light on a very important topic. To say who his successor was, he pointed at Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullahi alayhi, and said, هَذَا وَلِيُّكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِي. This is my successor, your successor, after me. And he raised his hand and said, اللَّهُمَّ وَالِي مَنْ وَلَاهُ عَادِي مَنْ عَدَاهُ وَانْصُرْ مَنْ نَصَرَهُ وَاخْذُلْ مَنْ خَدَلَهُ اللَّهُ for whoever I am his leader, Ali is his leader. O God, love those who love him and oppose those who oppose him. So brothers and sisters, the true image of Islam and these historic events that happened were slowly eliminating the true Islamic values and teachings. Events like burning the ahadith, interpolating the Sharia law, adding and removing new ideas that benefited their judgment and teachings to remove and make the true Islam vague to what it truly is. What I want you to take from this section, brothers and sisters, is that the Islam that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the Islam that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, perfected on the day of Ghadir, was slowly becoming a part of the past due to the injustice upbringings and due to the corrupted leader's negative influence. The question is then asked, why didn't the war of Karbala occur at the time of Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi? If the whole reason happened because he wasn't the Khalifa. It's very important to know, brothers and sisters, that before Rasulullah appointed Amir al-Mu'mineen as his successor, he talked to Amir al-Mu'mineen, he told him how to guide the Ummah, he gave him advice. And most importantly, he told him to not raise his sword, no matter what the reason is, no matter what happens, to not raise his sword on anyone. And that's indeed what Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi did. You know, it's like, let's say for example, you have an athlete, a basketball player for example. You know, he's the star of the team. He's the best player on the team. Everyone knows his capabilities. But for some reason, you know, the coach decides to bench him for a game. For whatever the reason may be. The player has to respect the coach's decision. In the end, the coach is the leader. He's the one who guides the team. You have to respect the decision and you have to follow that. So similarly here, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib salamullahi alayhi was told by Rasulullah to not raise his sword no matter what the case is. And that's what Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi did. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib salamullahi alayhi was able to go into war with the enemies. Of course, we all know how brave Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi and how strong he was. But of course there was a reason for that, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't want him to do that. And the main reason was because Islam was still in its early stages. Islam was still a baby growing. So people were gradually joining the religion of Islam and being impressed by the stories and the miracles and the Islamic teachings and the blessings and justice. So the best way at that time of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was to win the people's hearts, was to bring them to the religion. And by, you know, opening a war and starting a war, that's not going to win people's hearts. So the way to win them was with Islam's nurturing and respective teachings. You know, people at that time were sick of wars, wanted peace, wanted safety, wanted comfort, wanted charity, and most importantly, wanted a community to be accepted in. So any sudden split or change in the Islamic Ummah would have a negative influence on the religion and would let people go away than to bring them. Here we realize, brothers and sisters, why there was no need for Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib to raise his sword and sacrifice his life, the same way Imam Hussein did. Even though the Khilafah was taken from him, and it was 100% rightly his. Imam Ali, basically as we would put it, went with the flow. But that doesn't mean he didn't stand up to what was wrong, and didn't do Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahy an Munkar, and didn't oppose, you know, some of the decisions that the Khalifa did at that time. You know, it was said that Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi, at the time when Umar was the Khalifa, he used to correct sometimes Umar's narrations and assist him with certain events, so much to a point where we have narrations, a narration that says, لَوْلَا عَلِي لَهَلَكَ عُمَرُ. If it wasn't for Ali, Umar would have been perished. Salah ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Often at times, brothers and sisters, our focus is mostly about Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And sometimes we neglect to look at the history of our other Imams, salamullahi alayhim. For instance, Imam Al-Hasan alayhi salam, the brother of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. One of the most important actions that Imam Hassan alayhi salam did at his time was that he agreed a covenant with Muawiyah in order to later enable his family to take the Khilafah when Muawiyah dies. That being that Imam Hussein salamullah alayhi to become the Khalifa after the death of Muawiyah. But of course one might ask, why did Imam Hassan alayhi salam do this with Muawiyah? Why did he do a covenant with Muawiyah, a deal with Muawiyah, if you want to say? Why didn't he start a revolution? This all comes to understanding, brothers and sisters, that there is a certain place and time for everything. Society at the time of Imam Hassan alayhi salam did not really know which side was the good side and which side was the evil. What do I mean by this? I mean that Muawiyah, la'anatullah alayhi, was a hypocrite. And what does a hypocrite mean? It is an individual who publicly displays something, and in closed doors and in private doors, displays the complete opposite. And this is exactly how Muawiyah was. Muawiyah was clever enough to not explicitly show his sinful actions. At some points, he used to praise the Ahlul Bayt and praise Imam Ali alayhi salam, but in closed doors, he would pay people to talk in an ill manner about Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. So basically, they could do the dirty work for him, and he could, you know, have his image the way it is. So he seemed like this religious, pious leader of the Muslimin, but in fact, he wasn't. Furthermore, Muawiyah used to lead the Jama'ah prayers. He used to lead the Muslimin in their prayers at the mosque. So Zahiran, through his appearance, he seemed like a good leader, a good man, in the eyes of the public. So there was little to hold against him. So how can Imam Al-Hasan alayhi salam declare a war with Muawiyah? Under what basis? And what threat? The public here will turn on Imam Hassan alayhi salam and denounce him as an evil and violent leader because he declared a war on a pious Muslim follower, Muslim believer, Muawiyah, which he wasn't, of course. Therefore, it was Imam Hassan's best interest to come with peace with Muawiyah and agree on a covenant that after his death, the Khilafah would return to the holy household of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
While on the other hand, his son Yazid la'anatullah ta'ala alayhi easily ruined his reputation with his own hands. He publicly drank alcohol. He publicly killed innocent people. He publicly talked in an ill manner about Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. But even over all of this, the battle of Karbala begun because Yazid violated the covenant that his father made with Imam Hassan alayhi salam, which was that after his death, Imam Hussein is the Khalifa and takes the Khilafah. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. So Yazid forcefully took and did whatever he could in order to gradually destroy the Islamic Ummah and transform it however he pleases. My dear brothers and sisters, this was all due to the corruptive leaders that altered and manipulated Islam to fit their own personal agenda. When Yazid became the Khalifa, he ordered his governor in Medina to go to Imam Hussein and to bring him and to tell Imam Hussein that Yazid wants him to pledge the allegiance for him. So the governor brought Imam Hussein salam Allah, and he told him that Yazid has become the Khalifa and he wants the pledge of allegiance from you. And Imam Hussein salamullah alayhi, after a discussion that took place with the governor, told him, I come from a house of justice, a house of kindness, the house of religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a man like me cannot pledge allegiance with a man like you. Mithli la yubayi'u mithla. That was one of the earliest calls for freedom and social justice. Here I want to ask you, brothers and sisters, do you blame the grandson of the Holy Prophet for standing up to this corruption and sacrificing everything he has in order to ignite the revolution? There was a cry for change, a need for something to wake up the Islamic Ummah from its current state. And no one other than Imam Hussain salamullahi alayhi stood up for this cry, him and his 72 companions in Karbala. If we stopped and accepted Yazid as the Khalifa back then and forgot the importance of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam and the Prophet in our daily lives, the Islam we have today would not be the Islam that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, fought for.
Allah
would not be the Islam that Sayyidah Fatima Zahra salamullahi alayha miscarried her child Muhsin for. Would not be the Islam that Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib was killed on a prayer mat for. And just like our Imam Hussain salamullahi alayhi says, death with dignity is better than a life of humiliation. So this is why the revolution could not have happened at the time of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib or at the time of Imam Hassan. What we see here is at the time of Yazid la'natullah alayh, the situation of the Muslim community became different and changed for the worse. Bani Umayyah took over the hukum and began implanting their own ideologies about Islam. They were twisting narrations to their own benefits. It was definitely the time for Imam Hussain salamullah alayhi to rise, to do amr bil ma'roof and nahi an munkar, to rise and do good and stop the bad that is being committed. It is important to know here, brothers and sisters, that even though Imam Hussain salamullah alayhi knew what his fate was, he still didn't leave the Kufa without a plan and without determination to make the situation better. Imam Hussain salamullah alayhi strategically thought of this revolution as a win-win situation. Either he goes to Kufa and the people of Kufa keep their word and they pay their allegiance to Imam Hussain salamullah alayhi and keep their promise, successfully taking over Kufa, which is the city of his father, Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah, and then using Kufa as a base to launch the real Islam. Or the other possibility for our Imam, salamullah alayhi, is to get martyred, and the martyrdom of the grandson of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, would cause an uprising in the Ummah. In the end, he is the son of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
So brothers and sisters, Imam Hussain salamullah alayhi sacrificed himself for the islah and the reformation of the ummah. And we need to realize, brothers and sisters, that Ashura is not just a historic event. It's not a fairy tale that we hear. It's not a ritual. If so, what differs us from the Jews, for example, who cry and mourn for the destruction of the Jewish temple? Islam is a religion, it's not a religion of just commemorating rituals and just crying and performing ghusl. Even though it is almost the habit, it is all good to do. Our Imam Salam Allah wants us to do that, want us to cry for Imam Hussain Salam Allah. Imam Rida Salam Allah alayhi tells one of his companions by the name of Ibn Shabib, he says, Ibn Shabib, in kunta bakiyan li shay' فَبْكِي لِلْحُسَيْنِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ فَإِنَّهُ ذُبِحَ كَمَا يُذْبَحُ الشَّاتِ. Imam Rida is telling his companion Ibn Shabib that if there was anything to cry for, it is for Imam Hussain salamu Allah alayhi. He was slaughtered the same way they slaughtered the sheep. Also, another narration by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, كُلُّ الْعَيُونَ بَاكِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. All the eyes will be crying on the Day of Judgment except the eye that cried Imam Hussain salamullahi alayhi. Sallu ala Muhammad wa alayhi.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alayhi.
So brothers and sisters, when we listen to the majalis of Abi Abdullah al-Hussain, let us try to listen from our hearts and truly ask ourselves, what have we really understood from the revolution of our beloved Imam salamullahi alayhi? What did we learn from his revolution? How are we applying his teachings in our day-to-day life? Are we following his path? Are we doing what he wants? When we listen to the majlis and we perform the latim, we need to commemorate Imam Hussain salamullah alayhi truly from our hearts. We need to feel that we have gained something. Inshallah, throughout these 10 days, you have to feel something. You have to feel that you've changed somehow. You've made some connection with your Imam through these majalis, a spiritual connection with your Imam, salamullahi alayhi. I remember one of my teachers used to tell me that Imam Hussain, salamullahi alayhi, in Karbala, taught us jihad al-nafis, the struggle against the self. Because in merely two words, he could have solved the whole problem. He could have accepted Yazid as the Khalifa of the Muslimin, and gave his allegiance to Yazid and went home peacefully with his family, nothing would have happened to him. He could have went back without Zainab being masbiya, without Zainab being dragged from place to place, without Abbas losing his arms, without any of his children suffering, without his companions all dying. If only Imam Hussain accepted Yazid's Khilafah. So imagine, brothers and sisters, someone is making you agree to slaughter your companions, your kids, your family, humiliate your woman. Normally when we relate it to our nafis, imagine we have the choice to either becoming popular and rich by committing a sin, or to live a righteous life knowing that we have a place in the akhirah, in the hereafter. What a great temptation that is for someone to fight his nafs. Oftentimes, we fall short and put this dunya in front of us, put the worldly desires in front of our Islam. But Imam Hussain salamullah alayhi put keeping the true image of Islam alive and put Islam in front of himself. Imam Hussain salamullah alayhi got to this point by jihad al-nafis, which inshallah we will discuss tomorrow, the importance of jihad al-nafis, what jihad al-nafis is, how to struggle, how to battle our nafis, inshallah. It all began and ended with jihad al-nafis, from the companions of Imam Hussain, from Abbas, Abul Fadl al-Abbas, Ta'awun, to Muslim ibn Aqil, all of these companions of Imam Hussein could have rejected Imam Hussein's invitation, just like the many that fled and left Imam Hussein alayhi salam alone. But these loyal and sincere companions of our Imam salamullahi alayhi gave up everything to fight for their Imam salamullahi alayhi and to fight for the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They gave everything they have. Now, unlike us, sadly, sometimes we can't even give our phones away or stay away from the TV to perform our salat. These people gave their lives to fight for Islam, to fight for Imam Hussein. Not for salat, not for something wajib that is an obligation on each and every one of us. No, to fight for Islam. To keep the religion of Imam Hussein salamullahi alayhi alive. To keep the Islam al-Muhammadi al-Asil. I'm sorry, brothers and sisters, but I still have some questions that I want you to ponder upon. Does the war of Karbala still not happen until today? Do the true followers of Imam Hussein salamullahi alayhi still exist? They still live between us? Don't you think that these type of soldiers are the soldiers that Imam al-Mahdi ajalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif is waiting for? So when Imam al-Mahdi ajalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif says, "Hal min nasirin yansurun?" Are we going to be from the Ansar of our Imam salamullahi alayhi? Or are we going to use the luxury of our lives or our families as an excuse not to fight with our Imam salamullahi alayhi? And not to reach the high privilege of being with the Imam salamullahi alayhi? Akh ya sahib al asri wa zaman, O Imam al-Mahdi ajallahu ta'ala farajahu. How much do I hurt your heart when I bring up your grandfather's final death? How much does your heart hurt knowing that your grandmother Sayyida Zainab was forced to remove the crown of Islam off her head, her hijab? And yet we have sisters who don't even wear the hijab. How does it feel to know that your soldiers are not ready and are putting this dunya in front of them? How much does it feel to know that your soldiers have betrayed you? Just like those who betrayed Muslim ibn Aqil and left Muslim ibn Aqil alone. Brothers and sisters, tonight is the night of Muslim ibn Aqil. Muslim ibn Aqil, the companion of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, the cousin of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, was the ambassador of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, sent to Kufa. Imam Hussein salamullah alayhi sent Muslim to Kufa. The people of Kufa told Imam Hussein to come because they were ready to fight with him and battle with him. So Imam Hussein salamullah alayhi sent Muslim ibn Aqil to go and see these people, gather the people, talk to them, bring the people. And indeed, Muslim ibn Aqil gathered as much people as he can. Some narrations say he gathered around 30,000 people. He gathered these people, he talked to them, and they were all ready, motivated to fight for Imam Hussein, to fight for the sake of Islam, to fight for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muslim ibn Aqil then took the people, they went to the mosque to pray. He prayed Salatul Jama'ah with thousands of people behind him. After he finishes his Maghrib prayer, Muslim looks behind him. There's only 10 people left. They have betrayed Muslim ibn Aqil. Muslim ibn Aqil continues his Salat. He prays his Isha prayer. He finishes and he looks behind him. There is no one. Muslim ibn Aqil is left alone, a stranger in a city he doesn't know. He has no place to go, no shelter. Muslim ibn Aqil then goes to walk through the alleys of the streets of Kufa until he reaches a house. He sees an old lady sitting outside, a lady by the name of Tawa. He comes to Tawa, he asks her kindly, may I have a drink of water? Tawa gives some water to Muslim ibn Aqil, he drinks, and she enters back in her house, but Muslim remains sitting outside on her door. She sees him still sitting outside, she comes to him. O servant of Allah, why are you still sitting on my door? Didn't you drink? Muslim ibn Aqil said, yes. Then why are you still sitting on my door? He didn't reply to her. She asked him another time. Muslim ibn Aqil didn't reply to her. He told her, Amatallah, can you please allow me to stay this night at your house? I have no place to go. I have no family here. And inshallah, I will reward you on the Day of Judgment. Tawha looked at Muslim ibn Aqil. As soon as he said that, who are you to reward me on the Day of Judgment? Man anta hatta tukafi'uni yawm al-qiyamah. He looked at her and said, Ana Muslim ibn Aqil ibn Ammi al-Hussain. I am Muslim ibn Aqil, the cousin of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. The people of your village have betrayed me and have left me all alone. As soon as Tawa heard that, she welcomed Muslim, she greeted Muslim, she apologized to Muslim. She let him go inside her house, she fed Muslim, she gave him some food, some water, a place to stay in. But unfortunately, Tawa had a son that was a soldier of Ibn Ziyad. He came home and realized that there was someone in the house. He asked his mother Tawa, who do we have here? She told him that she will tell him if he promises her not to tell anyone. And she told him, as soon as she told him, her son went to Ibn Ziyad, he ran to Ibn Ziyad and told him where Muslim was. And they sent an army to the house of Muslim. They surrounded the house. She apologized to Muslim ibn Aqil and told her that they came for him. He tells her not to worry and that she's done more than enough for him. And she gave him his sword, and Muslim ibn Aqil started battling the men like a brave man. They sent more and more men until they wounded Muslim badly. But Muslim was still fighting them. They told Ibn Ziyad that they wanted more soldiers. Ibn Ziyad told him he was only one man. They told him, you don't know who this one man is. He is Muslim ibn Aqil, the cousin of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. He sent them more men, and Muslim was still battling them bravely until they trapped Muslim ibn Aqil. They dug a hole. And they pushed Muslim ibn Aqil in it. And they captured Muslim ibn Aqil. And they took him to the palace of Ibn Ziyad. They captured Muslim ibn Aqil and took him to the palace of Ibn Ziyad, where he ordered them to throw his body from on top of the palace to the ground. Muslim ibn Aqil then asked them to pray. He wanted to perform the last salat before he dies. He prays, he performs the salat, then he faces Medina, and he sends his salams to Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. He says, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. هذا ابن عمك مسلم ابن عقيل غريب في هذا المجلس. Oh Abi Abdullah, this is your cousin Muslim ibn Aqil, all alone in this city. I have no one in this city. They all have betrayed me and turned against me. Then they struck Muslim twice. His head fell off his body. And then they threw him on top of the palace to the ground. رحم الله من نادى ومسلما وسيدا وشهيدا. And then they dragged Muslim ibn Aqil on the streets of Kufa. والله عادت المستجير يكون ينجى يا ينجى روح القطلة حليف الشرف ينجى يا مثل مسلم صدق بالحبيب ينجى يا وتتنام سبق اطلع لو جميل يا وتتنام سبق اطلع لو جميل. It doesn't end there, brothers and sisters. The news reached Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. Abi Abdullah ordered them to bring him Muslim's daughter. Muslim had a daughter by the name of Hamida. They brought Hamida to Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. Abi Abdullah sits her on his lap, comforts her the same way he comforts the orphans. Hamida realized that Abi Abdullah al-Hussein was acting different with her. She asked him, is my father okay? Amma, is my father okay? Is Muslim ibn Aqil okay? Imam Hussain cried and told her, oh little girl, I am now your father, and my daughters are like your sister. أبو أنا صرت لك يا حميدة شوفت والدك صارت بعيدة Seeing her father is now impossible What does she say to أبي عبد الله الحسين عم يا حسين قل لي عما يا حسين من زمان ما بين علينا It's been a while we haven't seen him عما يا حسين كان ابويا قاتلينا السلام عليك يا مسلم ابن عقيل وعلى ابن عمك أبي عبد الله الحسين عليه السلام Let us send our salams to أبي عبد الله الحسين Everyone together السلام على وعلى علي بن وعلى Raise your hand for dua. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma inna nas'aluka wa nad'uk bi habb al khalqi ilayka Fatima wa abiha wa ba'liha wa baniha wa sirr al mustawda'i fiha ma tarakta lana dhanban illa ghafartah wa la hamman illa farajtah wa la sukman illa shafaytah ولا عيبا إلا سترته ولا حاجة إلا قضيتها يا أرحم الراحمين وصل اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل بيت الطيبين الطاهرين all our dead ones إلى أرواح أمواتنا جميعا رحم الله من يقرأ سورة المباركة الفاتحة مسبوقة بالصلاة على محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد